If we go back in time, 10s, 100s of thousands of years, then the Asian elephant population was much bigger. They were almost like one very big population. Their habitat was connected everywhere. But if you compare that to now, over the past 3 generations or so, their numbers dropped more than 50%. What makes me most hopeful is that you can actually make a change. We are in this library with all these books. There's different stories about elephants described in the distant past, expeditions that were undertaken. All the animals that are described in there, those are the ancestors of the animals that actually are in the zoo here today. What I think is really cool is that one elephant in the zoo is also a library, containing all these stories of the ancestors about selection, about population crashes, ice ages, but then in their DNA. That tells the story about what happened in the past, but what happened in the past we can use to make a difference in the future. I specialize in digging deep in whole genomes, so that is all the DNA that is present in an individual, and look at patterns of diversity in that DNA. It's such a big puzzle, and I like puzzles. And this is a puzzle with millions and millions of pieces. If we were to write out all the stories that are in the DNA of these animals, we could fill books of only 4 letters, A, T, C, and G, that's it. But that's billions of letters long. If you were to print it out on paper, you could probably fit it in this entire library. The fact that we have all these samples from these elephants in European zoos provides us the opportunity to really dive into the histories of these populations, where they are coming from in the wild. When we have this fresh blood sample, we take this to the lab. What we do is break open the cells and only keep the DNA. And with this DNA, we go to a fancy machine where we put the DNA in the machine, and it will spit out sequence of letters. When we talk about DNA, this is basically what it looks like. DNA is only 4 letters, A, T, C, and G, in a very long string. Basically, what we do is compare strings of DNA and see where the differences are. We need diversity. The differences can be minor, changing one letter in a word, saying the instead of the. Well, still, the story will not really change. There are some particular mistakes, though. You can think about a name that is swapped, or maybe a page that appears somewhere else in the book that is completely changing the plot. And therefore, these two copies all of a sudden are very different. And those are the types of mutations that are important for the survival of the species as well. You can travel back in time up to 1 million years, sometimes even further, and see the footprint of these ice ages, populations being very small, only few animals left, and then expanding again. That pattern we can read back in the DNA. But also a lot of diversity that emerged in the past and it is still there nowadays.
Nou, dit is natuurlijk eigenlijk alle landen en gebieden die we nu hebben.
Ja, en dat zijn al die, eigenlijk alle dierentuinsamples waarvan ja. We denken dat dit de wilde oorsprong is, toch?
Ja, en daar zag je eigenlijk ook heel mooi die gaten in die populaties die natuurlijk wel ooit bestonden.
En ook als je kijkt naar hoe gefragmenteerd dat landschap hier is.
Ja.
Het zou zomaar kunnen dat wat er in die dierentuinen zit, dat niet meer bestaat. They used to have a very wide distribution and nowadays their populations are fragmented. And we can already predict that problems will occur if these populations remain so small. Ja, dat is wel echt dramatisch, hè?
Ja, en dat is echt bizar, bizar hoog.
So what we're seeing here is one representative individual and the pattern of diversity along those genomes. And that is a measure of overall genetic diversity that is present in that population or in that subspecies. We can see, oh, there's inbreeding going on in this population at this moment. Or we can see there's a lot of harmful mutations present in this population, so we need to introduce healthy genes, basically, to make it future-proof. The more genetic diversity there is, the higher the chances that you are capable of adapting. That will provide the fuel and the potential, basically, for the species to exist in the future. The most important thing that we can do now is prioritize populations by looking at their DNA. We can predict what will happen and which ones need the most conservation action. We need to change conservation genetics to a proactive discipline so we can act before it's too late. I can do my nerdy thing, dive into these genomes, and at the same time have a very real and practical impact for the species that I care so much about. This is biodiversity. This is to me like the biggest source of biodiversity and also what we should protect. Thank you.